Paris in November, and it really brings forward a strategy for members to consider. It's based on the appendix. The appendix is quite a substantial document, climate change investment solution, about asset owners, which has been principally driven by IIGCC, the Institutional Investor Group on Climate Change, of which the fund is a member. And in considering climate risk options, the intention of officers is to look at the strategic approach of the fund. I think it's important that the fund considers the kind of approach it wishes to take. Our responsible investment strategy is quite clear that we tend not to divest from stocks or sectors on ethical grounds, but we think it's right that climate change and carbon risk is seen as an investment risk. As the report sets out in some detail, it's clear from the agreement reached in Paris that there will be a framework for carbon pricing going forward, and the expectation is only that carbon pricing will increase in the future. But in a sense, the strategy that we're proposing is almost agnostic on carbon pricing, but it recognises that the carbon and carbon emissions are a risk due to government strategy, and for a long-term investor like the pension fund, it's important to put a strategy in place to manage carbon risk. So we go into some detail, really distilling the appendix, and we set out under section two some of the key issues and some of the key considerations in thinking about a climate risk strategy. For example, at the end of section 2.3, we say that divestment from fossil fuel companies does not adequately address the need to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, as it doesn't remove capital from companies with high carbon exposure, but rather denudes the value of ownership by transferring it to others who care less about the problem. Whereas a decarbonisation strategy maintains the importance of ownership while still aiming to send a strong and unequivocal signal to the primacy of carbon efficiency by a process of reallocation of capital at scale, so that we in a measured way reallocate capital away from high carbon intensity industries and stocks towards lower and more efficient companies and stocks, and ideally also to companies that are mitigating climate risk and climate change. Under 2.4, we've set out some of the considerations around measuring the carbon footprint of our portfolio. We think it's very important that we have a consistent way of measuring the carbon footprint of our portfolio. Once we can measure it, and we're already working with companies and other investors to encourage a consistent approach to reporting. Companies do report their carbon, but it's not very consistent at the moment. So by improving the consistency of reporting, we can measure that, we can then manage it, and we can then take steps to reduce the fund's carbon footprint. So under section 2.5, we suggest that an area where members could consider taking some steps to reduce the fund's carbon footprint is in relation to the two passive mandates that we have, one in the UK and one in the US. This would be a way of managing our passive assets and looking to decarbonise them without taking undue investment risk. And although it would have increased cost considerations, we feel it's right to consider that money is appropriate to spend money in terms of managing the risk, such as carbon risk. So at the bottom of the fourth page, we do say that such an approach would not be without risks and costs, but the practical considerations are set out below, that officers would consider a number of low carbon indices. We look at those on the basis of their ability to deliver a carbon reduction benefit. We point out the need to have a higher tracking error for the mandates, and that it will probably be implemented through a managed account, which is a segregated mandate, which would increase both the transaction costs and the ongoing management costs. There'll be a higher point six, we explain why we feel it's less appropriate to extend carbon reduction objectives to the fund's active mandates, but nonetheless the fund should seek to better understand the climate risk exposure of these portfolios. Then under section 2.7, we effectively extract a table from the appendix which goes through four stages, a strategic review, followed by strategic asset allocation, followed by mitigation actions or adaptation actions. And in the table, under each of those four headings, we make some suggested actions. In the third column, we set out the fund's current responsible investment policy. And then in the fourth column, we set out some potential actions that officers consider could be appropriate for the fund. And clearly we're seeking the views of members as to whether we should take some or all of those forward. Under section 3 we set out the relevant risks. Climate change is a systemic risk with major implications for a long-term investor, such as Merseyside Pension Fund, and we feel it's appropriate to have a proactive and precautionary approach. However, an ill-considered and hastily implemented decarbonisation plan may jeopardise other investment strategy objectives. Under section 8, we say something about the costs. Clearly, as we work, if approved, towards some of these goals, there'll be greater clarity that we can report back to committee on the costs of the strategy. So the recommendation under section 13 is that an initial decarbonisation plan for the Merseyside Pension Fund be progressed to encompass carbon footprinting of listed equities, reduction of exposure in the passive equities portfolio, and secondly, a strategic review be initiated along the lines set out in the attached appendix, with an updated policy statement on climate change to be included in the forthcoming investment strategy statement. Happy to answer questions, Chair.
Peter, thank you for that very detailed report and all the work that's gone into it. And Treena?
Thanks for that, Peter. I welcome that the fund recognises the need to progress the plan on decarbonisation. And I understand that there's a lot of work in relation to risk on data collection, cost, etc. However, I do welcome the recognition that the fund should seek to better understand the climate risk exposure. And I welcome that managers could also be required to include climate risk in their reporting going forward. So.
Thanks very much, Chair. Yeah, I'd just like to put on record my thanks to Owen for all the work he's put in on this issue. I'm very happy, obviously, the committee has taken this particular topic forward. Just a couple of things I've drawn out of the report is that it specifically mentions on page 3 that, you know, France has introduced rules compelling carbon disclosure by institutional investors. And I know from speaking to some of the fund managers at our, you know, investment working party meetings, that they are being pressed a lot more on this kind of issue by our counterparts in France, Germany, Scandinavia, that kind of thing. So I think some countries are certainly ahead of the UK on this particular issue. And that, in my mind, just raises the risk profile. If other countries are moving ahead of us, then that increases the risk to our pensioners, you know, from the holdings that we do have in fossil fuels and the risk to those assets going forward. And also on page 3, you know, it's noted that in terms of the passive investments, that a relatively low degree of reweighting could achieve a significant decarbonising effect. So the question I've got really relates to both the recommendations in terms of what kind of timing we might see in terms of really, I suppose, pushing each of these separate recommendations forward. When we could really expect reasonably to hear back at committee level about, you know, further progress on both of those.
In relation to the investment strategy statement, that's something that's being brought in with the new investment regulations. So without avoiding timing on that, we're still waiting for the government to issue the revised investment regulations, and on the back of that, we'll be able to work officers can work on those straight away. Pooling is occupying a great deal of our time, but as you've heard, we need to have decisions made and things in place for that by the end of June. With committee's agreement, we could either make this a standing item on pensions committee, or we could make it a standing item on the investment monitoring working parties, which happen as members know on a quarterly or more regular basis, so that councillors can hold me to account on progress. It's taken us, as you know, from November, 4 months to get to where we are. I understand you spoke to Owen today, and he'd have perhaps given an indication on progress that we've made so far. But we have put some of the foundation stones in place already. But I'd be hopeful, certainly in 12 months, that we could have made some very tangible, concrete progress on this.
Thank you. Yeah, just follow up on that, and thank Peter. Very much welcome the suggestion that you form part of the investment working party meeting as well. I very much welcome that. I hope other committee members would support it too. Just one in terms of the pooling arrangements, which obviously we spoke about earlier, you mentioned just there. We have referred here to some additional costs associated with this. I'm just wondering if the pooling arrangements might offer some opportunity to mitigate those costs and also to propagate this issue, which I think we're taking a lead on in terms of the three funds that are involved in the pooling, to propagate that within those funds as well. And I suppose, in some respects, this does represent an opportunity for us to develop expertise, which I think we've got, which Owen has, I think, demonstrated in this report. We do have some expertise which could prove advantageous going forward, and of course in terms of any localised investment that might come out of the pension fund going forward, obviously I would be very much advocating that that is directed towards decarbonisation, the green economy, renewable energy, green buildings, etc. So, sorry, I don't know if you caught my question in all of that, but does the pooling arrangement offer any kind of opportunities to mitigate the costs?
Certainly, if we can get our pooling partners to get involved, then we can share the costs. My initial immediate reaction is West Yorkshire doesn't have any passive management, so there's not an immediate vehicle for them to get involved in from a passive aspect. Greater Manchester does have a passive fund, so we can certainly speak to them to see if